So, those are patty dried in a freeze dryer, and this is how the resin comes when it's been dried in a room and sieved with a metal sieve. So we're going to do some quality control tests, because when you look at the resin, the only thing that you can really see is the color and that it's clean. And that's not really enough indication on ripeness. To really know how good your resin head are, you really need to press and explode the membrane that holds the resin and make a mass of resin. That means that as soon, I will show you in my hand actually, you put the resin like this in the middle of your palm, and you put your thumb over it and you close your hand. And without really applying pressure, just the heat of your body and that slight pressure should start melting the resin together if it's of the highest quality. That means that when I open my hand, I should have stickiness here. The more you have to press to make a mass of resin, the lower the quality. So that you really can feel in your hand and smell the quality of the product. If you smell the resin here, it has basically no smell. If you work well, if your drying has been perfect, everything is retained in that membrane that you spend the whole process trying to protect. Now when you break it away, all the terpene come out and they get, how do you say that, they stay in the mass of the resin. But as soon as you start pressing a tiny bit your resin, the smell become more and more intense. And the technique I use, it's an application of hand-pressed ash. So one of the first questions I had when I came into the States and into the industry, I wasn't really yet starting to look for the science, but I had some serious questions. And one of them was, how come every producing country, everyone press their resin before they smoke? There is nobody who do not press their resin seriously before smoking. And some let it age. And people often use a strong source of heat to press. And for me, the heat always was the mean to use that sticky characteristic of the resin to your own advantage to make a mass of resin. But it seems that there is a lot more to it actually. There is a process called decarboxylation. The plant give all the cannabinoid with the CO2 molecule attached to it, what show as the A, CBDA, THCA, CBGVA. And that CO2 molecule is a problem when you smoke, because before the blood system, there is a curtain of gas that blocks CO2 molecule. That means that you will have less cannabinoid passing into your blood system if you have that CO2 molecule attached to it. Doesn't matter how much terpene to compensate. The process of decarboxylation starts when you dry. the plant. And the more heat is applied, the faster the process up to a certain point. So most people, when they smoke, they don't really think of decarboxylation. Decarboxylation is really strong into the edible industry. So most of the number I got come from the edible company. So when you transform, when you take away that CO2 molecule, you reach a point, 70%, where you will transform your THC, you will degrade your resin, the THC will transform into CBN, which is a more soporific cannabinoid, then you actually lose your CO2 molecule. So there is a plateau that you have to respect. In edible industry, basically, they consider at 180 degrees to 200 degrees Fahrenheit, you would need 30 minutes to 1 hour to do a decarboxylation. At 300 degrees Fahrenheit, you need 15 minutes. Over 320, you start degrading faster that you're losing your CO2 molecule. So also in the temperature you're using and the time you're applying your decarboxylation is very important. So all my technique is basically an evolution for a better world of hand pressing, because when I was young, in my travels, the highest quality was hand press. And to hand press, it's really hard work. It's like 15 to 30 minutes in the sun with a fire going on next to you, that your hands are always super hot. Often they slap the ash on the stone around the fire. And Afghani often add a little bit of water, that I've been wondering a lot why, because there is usually a reason behind whatever they do. Anyway, it's really a hard work, and it takes a very long time. And I needed a way to control temperature and be able to have that perfect pressure applied to the whole mass of resin that I wanted to press. And I came out super tech. I boil water. So water boil at 220. I put it in a big wine bottle, transparent, so that I can see what I'm doing. And I work like that. So by the time I start working with my bottle, I'm somewhere around 190, 200 Fahrenheit, and I work my ash for 10 minutes until I press it flat like a pancake. Then I fold it back and I press a second time and a third time, so that I have like 30 minutes or so at somewhere around 170, 180 Fahrenheit average. And at the end of the day, my ash has lost half of its CO2 molecule. And then the little bit, the rest will basically happen when you smoke. So when you smoke ash and it's been made into a mass, it takes time before it combusts. So you have a decarboxylation happening. Even if it's not the greatest, there is a further decarboxylation happening. If you have a product that, like an extract, that just combusts on a nail, because a nail is somewhere around 700, we are far away from the optimum temperature of decarboxylation. There is very few little decarboxylation happening. It's mostly a combustion. And the process of pressing goes actually further. You have to understand that a methodology that is used over thousands and thousands of years there is a very good chance that there is something solid behind the methodology, otherwise it would have died by itself and something better would have come out. So there is a lot of respect that has to be paid to the people who actually invented the game, because for most people that don't come from a hash producing country, people who grow the flower, not so long ago, you were growing flour without really having the knowledge of the importance of resin head, when everything is actually in the resin head. There is very little in the plant matter, even if the plant may bring a certain aspect of a certain medical aspect, as long as the psychoactive quality of the plant, everything is inside that resin head. The whole magic of the transformation happens there. So you have to give a lot of respect to those people who not only understood that the whole power is into those so minuscule resin heads that by you cannot even see them and they couldn't, but they understood the value of pressing. They could press in certain ways that without any containing opportunity, like a container that would protect your resin, there is places like Nepal where they use the resin to protect the resin. The Royal Nepalese Temple Bowl, it's basically a lot of little pieces of ash pressed together into a perfect blemishless ball of resin, and then they roll it in such a way that it creates a shell, a resin shell around the resin, and it can protect it for years. I actually smoked one in Nepal in 1980 that was 12 years old, and it was so intense I couldn't believe that it was so old. And I was really blown away by seeing that millimeter shell of resin, of hardened resin, protecting, I don't know, the ball must have been like somewhere around 30, 40 grams. And the inside was not only protected, but had become better than what it was when it was done. It's quite amazing. So there is a lot of respect to be given, but there is no study that have been applied to pressing. So when you decarb and you apply a heat that melts literally the resin into a mass, there is a strong chemical reaction happening into that mass of resin. It could be compared to a point to what's happening to when you crush grape. When you crush grape, you can drink grape juice, or you can make wine, and you can go even further than making wine, letting the process, the chemical process of fermentation happen, and then later on age it, and the final product is greater than the grape that was used. Even if the final quality is only dependent on that quality that is given, it's a little bit the same for the ash. We don't know the chemical process happening, but there is a strong chemical things happening into that mass of resin. And it's so strong that literally the resin eat away whatever is not resinous inside that mass. That means that if I press my resin now and I dab it, it may be not full melt. If I do that in 3 months, a year, 2 years, or 3 years, it will be dabbable, because the resin has taken over everything that wasn't resinous. So I really saw that outside that decarboxylation process and an activation, for a better word, of the cannabinoid, I thought I was looking in the mass of resin my terpene, because I know I keep them fully inside that mass. Lately, there has been some research done on hashish, like the final product, and the correlation with the plant dry and live. And they found out that you literally create 50 plus compounds that are super rare, so rare that they have no name, and you hardly find them in nature. One of these compounds comes so often that they want to call it hashishin. And the reason is that the terpene that creates that new compound, it's bimircene. And that's a terpene that is quite common in many, many strains. But there is like 40 plus other compounds that are created through the whole process of traditional hashish production. And this is only the tip of the iceberg. So it's like, how can you judge a product only on a color or on a cleanliness when everything really is inside that resin head? And until you press it and you make a mass of it and you let it show you how much resin there is inside, you cannot really know what you have. The color is not an indicator, and mostly it's actually a misinformation. Most people think that ripe resin on a plant, it's milky, and the beginning of amber is a degradation. It's absolutely not true. The plants produce, the resin head produce THC at 80% plus amberness in its head. So there is really a misinformation and a misunderstanding of what ultimum resin ripeness is. And the final characteristic of the resin is much more important than its final color, as long as your level of CBN, your level of degradation, is kept low. And usually when I press, I have a quarter of a percent of CBN for over between 70 to 85% of cannabinoid. So, and that little bit of of degradation on the other side is balanced by the potential of being able to age my resin, and aging bring a lot to the game, a lot that we have not even started to scratch the surface. But again, in producing countries, they don't smoke young resin, they smoke aged resin. When the Brotherhood of Eternal Love went to Afghanistan and started to buy large quantity of Afghani ash, after a very short time, they literally empty stock because the country was used to export, but not at that level. And from one year to the other, they started to smoke the ash made just the year prior. And everybody felt the difference in quality to the point that they actually started to make oil and press the resin with oil to keep the potency high enough. So now we're going to see, I've been showing you how it happened in a hand, and before you press with a bottle, I want you to experience it in your hand, because you're going to feel with more than your eyes exactly what is happening when you press resin together. You want to do that 15 minutes. It's a walk. It's not I'm falling asleep and being comfortable and playing around with a little piece of sticky stuff. You really need to work it out. You need to work it out to the point that you're going to have a blister. 15 minutes, it's very long. And I want you to keep your hand very hot. Like, for example, to keep it on a bottle of water, boiling water every minute or so, so that you keep the work as hot as possible with as much friction as possible. When your resin really starts to be melting together, you're gonna really feel it in the hand, you're gonna smell it. That experience will guide you when you have only your eyes to see the melt of the resin in under the bottle, under the weight of the bottle. It's like you need to do it only one or two times, but it's quite important that you suffer that much to be sure that you can really see what's happening and understand the whole process that is happening under your bottle. So when I put my bottle over it and it's melting by the weight of the bottle, that means that it's good. If it does not, it doesn't cut it. You see this one, how little is happening? You see this one, how much happened? And let's see that one. So you can see like the different level of quality. This is actually a 25 that I'm keeping for extraction, but I wanted to check it up. This one is much better. So we're gonna press this one and put those two on the side. And then I use the weight of my body as to put the pressure on it, so I don't use my muscle. I can press like somewhere around 350, 400 grams a day like that. It's a long process, it's a long work. You need to do both sides. A big bottle is very helpful. You can keep the heat longer, so you don't have to really change the water after every pancake, depending on the quality of the resin, though. That's good, but it's not of the highest quality either, but it's quite nice. You can really see the quality I'm going to show you when you start to get really a thin layer, how the melt become. It's like sometimes it's really just become liquid on the... And you see how on one side it's getting really melted. You see that little grainy sandiness? That's resin edge that have not been totally pressed. And here you can see it better. So it's really important to work both sides exactly the same number of time, because you don't really press both sides when you press on one. This is what I mean by showing the melt. Actually, it's much nicer than I thought. It become almost transparent, liquidy. So now, that's my first press. Okay, that was number one. You really want to crush all those resin heads into a mass. And at the same time, you're actually applying the decarboxylation. I usually work with a smaller bottle. So I was changing the water every time. With that huge bottle, it stays stable where, around the 200 for much longer. They actually are applying very little pressure here. The more you work it, the more malleable it becomes. If the quality wasn't really good enough, I wouldn't have been able to do it that many times. It usually doesn't keep the shape. You need to have a lot of resin to do that. So you see how difficult it's like when you know what's happening, what you see through that bottle that is quite nice because it's kind of magnifying glass. If you have not experience in your hand, it's really hard to understand what's happening. If you have, and you understand the texture of really well pressed resin, your eyes will be guide enough. You can see here. I usually don't go that far because I don't need, like, I'm showing off for you to. This gives you a good idea of the quality. And you see on the side how there is a kind of, you really see the line. There is a little dryness around on the edge. So it's quality, but it's not that full, pure melt, but it's already something quite impressive. And the smell of it. What's nice with resin, doesn't matter how sticky it gets to the plastic or to anything, the biggest piece of resin is going to collect everything else. Oh, I like that. Okay, now I press this into a temple bowl. What you really want, that there is no pocket of air inside, that the ball really become really dense. So when you finish rolling your temple ball, or can you hear the sound? There is a little ch-ch-ch-ch-ch stickiness to it. That's music to the eye. The stronger it is, the higher the quality. If you have a hard time just taking it off your hand, then it's really great. This one, it's somehow in between. It come out, it's gonna come out a little dull, and then slowly, slowly, the resin starts to seep out of the bowl and it becomes shiny. It really, like, literally ooze the resin. People think that I polished my bowl. I do nothing. It's the quality of the resin that is showing off. So this one is already a good quality because there is already a serious shine to it. And then it should shine more, and the high quality, the temple bowl can't even hold its shape. It melt down to a pancake shape. It's quite nice. So once this is done, I have been through a lot of I could call that research. What to do now? Do I let it sit a little bit on my shelf to settle down before I pack it for aging? Or do I want to lock it down like you put the wine straight up in a barrel, straight up so that the fermentation happens in a contained environment? So I'm opting for that. It's basically I want everything to happen in a closed-up environment. And I try to use my glass jar, but you never can fill it up that there is no oxygen except by making a hole in my lid, and I really don't want that. So the old school people were using cellophane paper. Before plastic, there was cellophane paper from natural fiber. And that's what actually I use. And I wrap my temple ball in cellophane paper, twist the top so that there is really no air, nothing with the resin, and I let it age like that. I just put it in a glass container in a dark place, a dark, cool place, like any cellar. Basically, like you would age wine. So I take the ash, and I simply wrap it as tightly as possible inside my cellophane paper so that I have no air, nothing that is left here. And I will not smoke this until it has worked its way for at least 3 months. Then I would age it. 3 months, 2-3 months is that first stage where all that chemical reaction has happened, it's settled down a little bit. The resin is in her final shape. Again, we don't know the process happening after, but the smoke become really smoother. There is a stronger body. And instead of feeling the terpene in the front, like when you smoke a young ash, it comes from the back. First, it takes your mouth, and then slowly, you have all the different profile of terpene coming in the back of the mouth. It's a very different experience, and it packs the punch because it finished a natural decarboxylation while it aged. So it's like, depending on how long I want to age my ash, my decarboxylation would be longer or shorter.